Everyone, the technical things today. So I'm very happy to welcome Max here with us, Bolivian-German writer, curator, philosopher, old friend. Great to have you in Portland. We've worked together in various ways for a number of years, so it's always a pleasure. It's great that you could come in the middle of this nightmare, and it wasn't too bad. It's like, I guess, in that year, it helped me feel that shit. What can I say about Max? Professionally speaking, the former director of Bolivian National Museum of Art, Museo Nacional de Arte, in the PAC. Currently, now, the artistic director for the Academy of the Arts of the World in Cologne in Germany, has worked with many interesting people, Alex Creischer and Andreas, Siekmann, to do the exhibition Potosí Principle, co-author of the book Hélio, the block experience in Cosmococa, after all, MIT. Very much appreciated in general for what I could say is a principled and nuanced view on the role of art in the world, and very unusual in that ethics are wrapped in with the practice and a general idea of what it means philosophically to produce art now in the world. Singular thing. There are very few people who are so focused. And so it's a great pleasure to know you and to have you here today. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you. Well, thank you, everyone. First of all, thanks, Aaron, for the invitation. Thanks, Aaron, for just helping me out with a lot of stuff. That's really great. And also, thanks to everyone for being here. It's a bit of a miracle that we can travel. And I'm going to push it a bit and talking with Aaron. If you don't mind, I would take off the mask since we're in a kind of safe distance. So thank you for that. There's a little thing on the floor. I'll just close. Okay. Thanks again, Aaron, for the presentation. There's, I think, just in the midst of what Aaron said, I'm going to present some thoughts that on a different occasion I had published in several texts in a newspaper in the past in Bolivia. I would like you to know a bit of the Bolivian context. I live in the past. Bolivian German. I grew up here and there, traveling back and forth all my life. And the Bolivian context is kind of particular. We have we've had a couple of tough years recently. In November 2019, after the election, which was won again by the left-wing party, which is called Movement Towards Socialism. Political instrument for the sovereignty of the people, that's the name of the party, right? So Movement to Socialism, political instrument for the sovereignty of the people. And this party won the elections, which is not really surprising since Bolivia has a two-third indigenous population. And this is the only party that provides proposals for rights for indigenous people in Bolivia. I'm going to move this a bit. And so as long as there are going to be elections, democratic elections, I guess it's fair to say that there's a two-third majority potential in this country. The right, actually days before the election, right-wing parties, a sort of broad coalition of right-wing movements and people said that there would have been election fraud already before the elections. So what happened was a coordinator, a coup d'etat that brought the president Evo Morales to fall, and by a recommendation of the military, so the military asked him to step down, which he did after he lost the police and the military. However, we had 1 year of intersection of right-wing neo-fascist, openly racist and sexist Christian fundamentalist regime. And in November of 2020, in October of 2020, we had elections again. And we left one with a striking 55% of the votes and an absolute majority. It was double as much votes than the left, the right wing opponent had in the election. So democracy is restituted in a way. What happened in that moment is something very particular. Before I moved back to Bolivia, I lived in Brazil for many years. And in Brazil, I experienced a coup d'etat against Dilma Rousseff. Dilma Rousseff of the so-called Workers' Party, PT, was also brought down by a let's say, constitutionally legitimate kind of coup that brought her down through through an impeachment process that was strongly mediated by mainstream media. And well, however, something that was similar between the situation in Brazil and the one in Bolivia is that both right-wing governments that came in after the coup d'etat respectively, first of all, brought down the Ministry of Cultures. It seems to be like a safe thing to say that right-wing governments in South America in the recent years have made that a habit to bring down the ministries of culture, respectively. And in Bolivia, after the left won the democratic elections and got back into power, restituted the Ministry of Culture and called it not, as it was called before, Ministry of Culture and Tourism, but now called it Ministry of Cultures, Decolonization and Depatriarchalization. I would like just to put you on that page, what it means to have a Ministry of Culture in a country that is governed by a party that is called Movement to Socialism, Political Instrument for the Sovereignty of the People. The Ministry of Cultures was restituted as Ministry of Cultures, Decolonization and Patriarchalization. That is quite a big name, right? So inherent to this, let's say, definition of what culture would be for the state apparatus, Bolivia, the state, as an organ of the state, the Ministry of Cultures, decolonization, depatriarchalization, then it does, I think, it's clear that we cannot divide culture from processes of decolonization, depatriarchalization, from the perspective of the current Bolivian government. The culture itself is inseparable from those processes of decolonization, depatriarchalization. I do share that with the current Bolivian government. I think that these are processes that are not to be separated, particularly living in times in which we're experiencing, I think, a historical shift of our political horizon to the right, and processes such as the invasion of the capital here under Trump, election fraud, screams of fraud when the right wing loses, and hostile, unconstitutional takeovers of governments are just our daily experience in different countries. So in these times, we do need, I think, to rethink what culture is and what its function could be for society. And this is something that Aaron mentioned. I do think about these things in my work as a writer, as a cultural theorist, if you like, a philosopher, and also as a curator and as a teacher. So I'm going to give you a sort of insight of the reflections I had in that year that we lived under a neo-fascist government in Bolivia, and my reflection about what it would mean to actually relink culture instead of abolishing it as a state project, a state-funded project, part of the state organ, of the apparatus, instead of getting rid of culture to link it up with processes of decolonization, depatriarchalization.
The basis, the very basis of my thinking that I'm going to present here, it's in, divided in four blocks. I'm going to read them to you. The very basis is that no such thing as experience of beauty can come without a price. And I say that we do have to understand what the historical price of the experience of beauty is in order to think what the function of beauty could be. So first of all, we have to analyze what is the historical price of the experience of beauty and who is paying it? Why do we not learn that in art schools? Why do we not see it? Why do we not hear it? So the invisibility and the silence around this, this price for the experience of beauty, the silence about who is paying that price of beauty, that is the core of the thoughts I'm going to present to you. Please allow me four blocks under the name of what I would call about adept with beauty. As a musician friend explains to me, silence is fundamental to our notion of sound. It means that it is from silence that we build our idea of what sound would be. Without silence, there is no sound. However, it makes me think that the problem is that everyone assumes that silence would be the natural parameter for what sound is. It is naturalized as necessary precondition for sound. No one seems to consider that silence itself can be something constructed. It can even be deliberate, just like sound. Silence, for example, is when someone keeps silent. It turns out that my friend is not only a musician, but also an anti-racist and anti-fascist activist and a researcher specializing in the history of colonialism. A certain silence, she explains, can be nothing less than an ideological mediation for the articulation of sound. When history is silent about the terror that the colony exercised in the name of God, when it is silent about racism and discrimination during the Republic, that is post-colony, when it is silent about the execution of indigenous populations from the political class, the exclusion, sorry. When history is silent, it is a precondition for the naturalization of the social hierarchies imposed by colonialism, for the naturalization of the contemporary massacres of our indigenous and peasant populations. It is the silence necessary to pretend to sing the song of freedom where democracy has long died. When there is silence, for example, because no one raises their voice, it may be first of all because they were intimidated, because they were afraid, because they were imprisoned, or because they were killed. In other words, what applies to psychoacoustics also applies to political history. Keeping people without paying attention to the silence de facto, to silence as a fact, to silence as silence, keeping people without understanding how the silence came about is the prerequisite for any ideological mediation of making people hear or not hear a sound, a voice, or their silence. On the other hand, my friend closes her explanation, once silence enters the consciousness as a constructed principle, as something made, no perception of sound will ever be the same again. The silence my friend talks about makes me think of other silences that are made of the same matter, silences that worry me. It makes me think, for example, of the silence of the museum, the silence that surrounds visitors in the museum when they contemplate works of art. What silence is that before the beauty of art? It can be confusing. It seems instead of one single silence, we're talking about at least two different silences that are intrinsically connected. One silence that claims something and one silence that keeps silent. First, the silence that claims is a silence that seeks to protect the beauty of art itself. There is something very particular about the beauty of art, so the ideologues of Western culture would have us believe. It works best with silence, wrapped in silence, mediated by silence. It requires silence. It is as if the silence manages to mediate beauty in a way that highlights its uniqueness and justifies its exceptionality. It is as if it manages to add an invisible value to it. It is a value that silence silently makes us feel without us noticing it is offered to us, promising, enchanting, overwhelming. We are delighted by something which, however free or public it may seem, it has a price with implications, a historical price. We are thus indebted to beauty, while silence settles the score. But this debt cannot be paid off at the ticket office, when entering or leaving the museum. This debt is an ethical debt, and it has to do with a constitutive contradiction concerning the appreciation of beauty of art. First of all, it is because of the price of silence that we can appreciate its beauty. The ideologues of European Enlightenment in the 18th century, the great philosophers and poets who celebrated aesthetic contemplation and silence, they defended the ideal that before the law and before beauty, everyone would be equal. However, they were also very clear on numerous occasions in emphasizing that everyone did not include either the indigenous nor the black people they called savages, and who by principle were excluded from the ability to contemplate or experience beauty, and that were also excluded from any form of reasoning, that is, they were considered incapable of consolidating or barely forming part of a cultural community, nor of a social organization that knew how to appreciate beauty. This, for the Enlightenment ideologists, also justified their deprivation of political rights. In the imaginary of the sub-ideologists of the colony, on the other hand, and up to the present day, the indigenous and the black are identified as hordes that first and foremost represent a threat. A threat to destabilize the order imposed by the cross and the armed force, that is the Christian cross and the armed force. And finally, they also represent a threat to beauty. The silence that claims, right, we had the first and the second silence, the silence that claims is a silence that claims lives in order to protect and appreciate beauty. It is made of the blood and bones, the ashes and the oblivion of those excluded from the experience of beauty. It is the silence that kills. The second, the silence that keeps silent, is different. It is a coward silence, one that tries to hide, one that is silence about the most irreverent and scandalous truth of beauty. That the beauty is not an essence. It is not a gift, nor a divine touch. Beauty is not a quality, nothing of the sort. Beauty is a condition. It is more. Beauty is its own condition. It is its own condition to be appreciated. Yes, we do owe a historical debt to beauty. Our debt to beauty is the struggle for the equality of conditions. Our debt is with all those excluded from the experience of beauty. Our debt is to understand silence, to learn to listen to silence, to understand how it was produced and what its interests are. To paraphrase the words of my research and anti-racist musician friend, a certain silence can be nothing less than the ideological mediation for the materialization of beauty. If we do not understand the silence that accompanies it, we will never understand beauty either. There's different ways of visibility is produced. I would like you to follow me on one path that will lead us to a certain way how the invisibilization of violences has occurred. And it has to do with the French philosopher Michel Foucault, who is considered to be, you know, one of the great thinkers of violence. However, he was, as many of his European colleagues, very Eurocentric. And it is interesting to contrast a bit where this thought ends up if we do contrast it, looking at it from the global south. So I'd like to share a thought on the migration of relations of violence with you. Do you know the book, what's it called? Discipline and Punish. I hope some of you have read it. However, you might recognize the first part of the book. It is the description of a execution by drawing and quartering, which was considered the last execution by drawing and quartering in Paris in the mid of the 18th century. So it is a pretty violent and explicit because Foucault explains details about this execution. So you are warned. "Kiss me, gentlemen," he said to his confessors, raised his head and looked at himself. Damien's own body had become the site of a bizarre spectacle. Only some moments before the executioner Samson, with his sleeves rolled up, had torn big pieces of flesh out of his tights with big glowing steel pincers that had been especially made for this occasion. Then at the two fleshy parts of the right arm, then at the breasts. Though a strong, sturdy fellow, this executioner found it so difficult to tear away the pieces of flesh that he set about the same spot two or three times, twisting the pincers as he did so. And what he took away formed at each part a wound about the size of a 6-pound crown piece. In these 6-pound crown sized holes, they would pour molten lead, boiling oil, burning resin, wax, sulfur, melted together. Then the ropes that were to be harnessed to the horses were attached with cords to the patient's body. The horses were then harnessed and placed alongside the arms and legs, one at each limb. Again, Damien raised his head and looked at himself. It is March 28, 1757 on Place de Grève, today's Place d'Hôtel de Ville in Paris. Robert François Damien, condemned and death sentenced for an attempted regicide, that is trying to kill the king, exclaimed horrible cries of pain while undergoing the most atrocious torture, conscious while being executed, burned, ripped in pieces and drawn apart. He cries, "My God, have pity on me, Jesus, help me, forgive me, Lord." Then, while the horses had a break to rebuild before yet another attempt to tug and tear him in four, he raised his head and looked at himself. And after contemplating himself, he said to the execution confessors, "Kiss me, gentlemen." The parish priest of St. Paul's did not dare so. So Monsieur de Marcilly slipped under the rope holding the left arm and kissed him on the forehead. There is something scaringly appropriate about the extension that Michel Foucault gives to his account of Robert François Damien's public execution. Three pages of historical quotes full of explicit description and details, atrocious cruelty and extreme violence. The first three pages of one of Michel Foucault's most celebrated books, Discipline and Punish, from 1975. Considered one of the most cited and quoted books in the humanities and social sciences departments of the Western Hemisphere, Western universities. At the same time, Damien's case marks an important moment in the general history of French jurisprudence. The bloody spectacle of Damien's notorious and controversial public execution was one of the last of its kind, at least in the French context. Never again France saw a public execution by drawing and quartering, rightfully considered the cruelest form of torture and execution of a human being. From this fact, Foucault establishes a true paradigm in the social and political sciences. He says that in liberal and democratic societies from the end of the 18th century on, punishment and violence are disappearing from the public visibility and public space and are moved to confined spaces such as prisons, barracks, hospitals, schools, etc. And second, that the relation of violence are transferred to the interior of the body. They are internalized through refined ideological mechanisms and social discipline. But, and this is interesting to think about, on the other side of the Atlantic in 1781, that is only 24 years after the last public execution by drawing and quartering in Paris, the Peruvian people at the main square in Cusco, at Plaza de Armas, witnessed one of the most famous cases of public execution in the history of the Americas. And at the same time, it was the first case of public execution in the history, by drawing and quartering in the history of the viceroyalty of Peru. That's 24 years after Foucault said that the last one happened in Paris. So 24 years after the last public execution by drawing and quartering in Paris, 24 years after in Peru, we have the first execution of drawing and quartering, right? This is the execution of the famous Quechua chief Tupac Amaru II, leader of the Gran Rebelión, considered the biggest anti-colonial rebellion of Hispanic America, which was from 1780 to 82. Tupac Amaru II was considered the biggest, well, most iconic political figure and patron of what would later be various anti-colonial and other liberation movements in Latin America. He's also the godfather of the name of Tupac Shakur, as you might know. So this iconic figure fought against the colonial oppression, and he was made the example of the first execution, public execution of drawing and quartering in the viceroyalty of Peru. Without wanting to narrow the historic weight of an attempted regicide, Damiens, Robert Francois Damiens, was a humble person. He was a dismissed domestic servant, and he was a lone perpetrator. His failed attempt to stab the French king with a small knife was declared the act of a demented person. Damiens, considered mentally unstable, had confessors waiting for him to speak out and show regret, but as we saw, Damien's last reported words were simply, "Kiss me, gentlemen." Amaru, Tupac Amaru II, on the other hand, had no execution confessors around him to ask him for a kiss. Amaru's sentence included cutting off his tongue in the first place. Too big was the risk his words could arouse the people. He was an exemplary, charismatic, anti-colonial revolutionary leader of his people, descendant from an Inca emperor blood dynasty. People would name themselves after him, would name their children after him, would name rebellions and later even streets, whole neighborhoods and monuments after him. In 1781, the Spanish certainly did not want Tupac Amaru II to speak out to his people at Cusco's central square before being executed. Instead, they let him be dragged by a horse from his prison cell where he had been tortured for days to Plaza de Armas, forced him to watch his wife, his children, and other members of his family getting killed, quartered, and cut into pieces before eventually he himself got to his turn. An eyewitness left us the following account. They tied four ribbons to his hands and feet and clutched them to the grith of four horses. Four mestizos started pulling them to four different directions, a spectacle that had never been seen in the city. They tried for a long time, but couldn't absolutely split the body even after they tucked him for a long time. So it remained suspended in the air in a spider-like state. It is noticeable how even while suspended between four horses, tugging to tear his body apart in what must have been indescribable pain, Tupac Amaru II's appearance to the eyewitness still recalls a creature that is commonly considered a threat, a big spider. The same must have seemed to the intimidated agents of penal power, who chose not to test the success of their horses, and after some unsuccessful attempts, stopped the tugging in order to first decapitate Tupac Amaru II and then cut his body into parts by cutting and sawing. However, the great rebellion was continued by the followers of Tupac Amaru, including Tupac Katari, whose last words, when equally executed by drawing and quartering shortly thereafter, had guided the insurgencies and intimidated colonial power, neocolonial democracy, and the white oligarchies in Bolivia and Peru ever since. His last words were, "I will die, but I will return, and I will be millions." What this Tupac Damien's dualism teaches us, the dualism between Robert Francois Damien's and Tupac Amaru II, is two things. First, that Eurocentric narratives, like the one from Foucault, they live from universalizing European events, just as white narratives live from universalizing colonial values. And the second thing it teaches us is that it teaches us something much more complex. It is that the invisibility of relations of violence, the invisibilization of the relations of violence does not mean that violence ceases to exist. On the contrary, violence is redistributed, focused, and intensified, right? So in the historical transition to a Eurocentric democracy, I call it a Eurocentric democracy because it has Europe in its center and ceases to see what happens around Europe and around democracy for it to exist. So in the transition to this Eurocentric democracy, relations of violence not only migrate to the interior of the people, being internalized through discipline and education, and thus becoming invisible, but at the same time, and this is what the narratives of the supposed neocolonial democracy do not tell us, let's remember that we're on neocolonial democracy here too, the relations of violence, the atrocious violence of dismemberments, of torture, of murder, it migrates to the colonies. It migrates to the rural areas. It migrates to the urban peripheries. And it migrates to the marginalized bodies. It migrates to the poor, to the indigenous, to the peasant bodies. The invisible violence is committed against people who have no visibility in the centers of hegemonic power, and against people whose death has no record in the hypocritical narratives of democracy and freedom that characterize neocolonial racism. For neocolonial racism, a single, we can skip this. It is important that we understand that the violence migrates to the invisible center, to the invisible places, to the invisible bodies, the ones that do leave no record in the narratives of freedom and democracy that characterizes neocolonial democracy. So what does that mean for our dealing with art? Sometimes I have the feeling people in the US forget that we're in colonial territory. The United States of America were built on the soil of others for the price of many lives and genocides of those who rightfully lived on their lands. And the history of art of these countries like the USA or Bolivia, the history of art is read in a certain way that I think we need also to reconsider. What does it mean, right? The beauty that we ascribe to art, to the history of the art of our countries. What does it mean? I'm going to shorten a bit my presentation and leave out one of four blocks that I had promised and just focus on the question that comes out of my experience in the museum, the National Museum of Art in La Paz, and ask ourselves, how can we decolonize art, taking, you know, all these background that I'm telling you about, this price of beauty, the price of the appraisal of the experience of beauty, the price of talking about democracy and talking about freedom. So how can we decolonize art from the perspective of a museum? There's a lot of talk about decolonization these days, and this is not only something in that happens in Bolivia, where, as I said, the Ministry of Cultures was restituted as a Ministry of Cultures, Decolonization, Depatriarchalization. For many years, over 10 years at least, I've been regularly invited to talk in one way or another on the decolonization of art in universities and museum, let's say prestigious centers of the so-called international art world. And unexpectedly, in the Bolivian context, where decolonization had been a crucial political term since 2005, when the movement to socialism, the political instrument for the sovereignty of people, took power, there's quite a resistance to this idea of decolonizing art and the decolonization of art. And this is because art, visual arts in particular, after 14 years of a socialist indigenous government in Bolivia, it seems that where the white elite could best remain in power without opening their hands and like remain attached to an institution of power was in the visual arts. Like the white elite had lost their power in the economy, it had lost its power in politics, it has lost its power in culture in general, but visual arts seemed to be the place where they could best hang on to. And it's something that I would like to ask you to think about. In other centers of the world, how the relation between white elites and arts is compared to other fields. So, however, when I was introduced as new director of the National Museum of Art at the press conference, even before I actually took office, a concerned member of the public, a white middle-aged woman, she told me that by talking about decolonization, my goal would be nothing less than wanting to destroy the museum's colonial artworks. The National Museum of Art has a large, one of the most important collections of colonial art. So this person in the public, while I was presented and addressed the idea, the ambition of decolonizing the museum and decolonizing art, said that my goal would be to destroy the artworks. What I have to say about this is something very simple. Decolonizing art does not mean destroying colonial artworks. It does not mean burning them down, and it does not mean making them disappear. On the contrary, destroying, removing, collapsing, burning cultural items was, historically speaking, exactly what the colonizers did. They did destroy artworks, make artworks disappear, etc., make histories disappear, and invisibilize histories, relations of violence, etc., how we've been talking. However, depending on who we ask, some 500 years ago, in an act of legitimate self-defense, it might have been considered a very good idea to kill all the whites and burn everything they brought with them, which would have saved the indigenous nations on our territories, on the Bolivian territory and on all American territories, 5 centuries of oppression, genocide, cultural extinction, looting, rape, extractivism, and the irreparable destruction of nature, which we are feeling strongly today. But today, in the young 21st century, the situation is very different, I like to say. Probably the ones who would benefit most from destroying colonial artworks would be the very reactionary forces that defend colonialism in the face of any effort of decolonization, whether in art, culture, in general, or in politics. With regard to patrimony, the most forceful effort to decolonize art consists precisely in taking care of colonial artworks, in studying them, in understanding them in order to learn from them, in order to learn what colonialism really was. This means in order to decolonize art, we must first of all deepen the study of colonial art. We must understand how colonial art functioned and what it was there for here in the Americas, but also in comparable contexts elsewhere. With all due respect to the very important research in the field, the history of colonial art in countries like Bolivia is still, it still has to be consolidated as a discipline. We don't have, we need to like establish a discipline that is actually able to study colonial art, not from the perspective of, you know, what colors were used, how is the composition, but against the background of everything that we've been talking here about so far. We have to establish a critical discipline that can be read side by side with the dominant Eurocentric art histories. We urgently need to rethink the dominant narratives, the narratives whose main objective was the representation and glorification of cultural expressions of the colonial era. To be able to carry out the project of our own and anti-colonial art history as a science, as a critical discipline, we must go beyond the descriptive phase, the necessary phase of inventorization of our patrimony, and finally exploit our capacity for critical analysis, to question in order to understand without fear of possible consequences, for example, that we learn to know about the price of the experience of beauty, right? Without fear of possible consequences, how did colonial art work? What did it serve for? And whom did it serve to in the first place? Finally, understand why our first and most important responsibility in wanting to decolonize art is to take care of it, to make it accessible and to make it known. We need to understand how this worked, this art, so that we can criticize it. Paradoxically, the colonial paintings are fascinating because they are frightening. They are of a frightening beauty. The magnificence of their beauty is only matched by how sinister the system is that they represent. Thus, the colonial paintings are at the same time works of singular beauty and documents of a regime structured by unparalleled violence, a regime that marked our history in a profound way and whose wounds and negative consequences we suffer up to this day, and which are perpetrated by also the contemporary art system. I would like you to think about this. In that sense, the very beauty of the colonial paintings is evidence of the arrogance of the colonization project. Imagine with what sort of beauty and traces they adorned themselves in such a genocidal project. This is arrogant. But we would not cite the colonial paintings as defendants in a courtroom of law. If we would go in court against them, against colonialism, we would not cite the paintings as defendants. The paintings are our witnesses. We need to understand that those paintings are our witnesses, and therefore they are our most important allies in the process of decolonization of art. In this process, an art gallery of colonial works is a cabinet full of witnesses tired of pretending otherwise. The decolonization of art is not solved by removing colonial works from a museum. On the contrary, removing them from the walls is only the precondition for being able to dust off the works, to be able to preserve them, open the doors and windows, let air inside and out the moldy air of the galleries, letting in enough oxygen to finally begin a process of decolonization, placing the works back on the walls and putting them right back on their place. We need to redefine how to speak and think of art, not only of colonial art, but also of contemporary art and our idea of beauty and our belief in beauty in order to be able to look for, we still haven't, and perhaps it's not really graspable, what the price of beauty really is. Thank you very much for your attention. So I would say we talk about these issues.
So we have maybe a few minutes for some discussion about this topic, and then I think we should take a break. break, and then continue the seminar after the break. That makes sense. So maybe 10, 15 minutes now, that's good time to for the discussion. Okay, so again, I'll hand over the mic for the other one.
Hello.
Hello. I sound important now. So what are some of the things that you personally are doing in your museum to deal with these issues of looking at the colonial past?
Unfortunately, I'm not at the museum anymore. With the coup d'etat, I got fired, right? It's fine. What did we do in the?
Can you say that again?
I was fired, as many people in hierarchical positions of state institutions were fired, and some were persecuted, incarcerated. It was a hostile, violent coup d'etat. So I was lucky compared to other people, right? But what did we do in order to raise consciousness about these things? Is that, for example, we try to ask ourselves how can we understand art, right? If I ask about the price of beauty, if I ask about what the depth is that we maintain with beauty for the experience of beauty, then we could start thinking about what actually is what we are considering art, taking for granted that art, the idea of art, is something imposed to people through educational systems, through ideological systems, and we actually could also very easily think that art is something else than what we learn at school or what we appreciate as beautiful or so. So Bolivia, let me explain to you, is a country that has a new constitution. Since 2009, it was re-founded, if you like, after being since 1825, the Republic of Bolivia in 2009, with a over two-thirds majority in parliament, democratically elected majority, there was the decision to rewrite the constitution. In that sense, Bolivia is quite a forerunner of different processes in different countries in the Latin American context. As for example, in Chile, there was a vote now to rewrite the constitution. In Ecuador in Colombia, they're calling for rewriting the constitution. I think yesterday or today, the president-elect Carrillo in Peru was finally accepted after the right wing was saying that it was election fraud, just as here in the US and Bolivia before, however. So there's also the call for a new constitution. In Bolivia, this process concluded in 2009 with the new constitution of the plurinational state of Bolivia. So Bolivia ceased to be a Republic of Bolivia, now is a plurinational state. That means plurinational state has to be understood according to the very text of the constitution, that the constitution recognizes 36 different nations, 36, and I quote, originary indigenous peasant and Afro-diasporic nations, 36 of them considered equal before the constitution, right? So Bolivia is a plurinational state, and the equality of these 36 originary indigenous peasant and Afro-diasporic nations is guaranteed by the constitution. So when we go into a museum that is called National Museum of Art, you already realize that there is a contradiction between a plurinational state and a National Museum of Art. What happened in the National Museum of Art is that the dominant narratives and how the collections were built up followed the idea of one nation, which actually means a dominant Eurocentric white nation that is the heir of the colonialism and colonial violence. So one of the first things that we did when I assumed the position to direct the museum was to ask ourselves, what is actually called art in all those 36 different languages? You know, do we use the same word for art? what does art mean in Quechua, in Aymara, in Guarani languages, and however we figured out that the notion that is dominant in art and in the imperial languages, English, French, German, Spanish, Portuguese, etc. Within the European mindset, there is one dominant idea of what art would be, and in different in the 36 Bolivian nations, there is not a comparable notion of art, right? So in 36 originary indigenous peasant Afro-diasporic nations, the notion of art is quite different, and art could mean, for example, things that are done with our hands, right? So this is the translation of art in, for example, Aymara. And so the idea of what art could be is related to things that are done with the hands and not to pieces that are hanging in colonial institutions on the walls and are considered beautiful, but things that are done with our hands. So we did a lot of talks, organized talks, in which we invited people who had never before come to the museum, because it was not only a white institution where the white elite remained in power even 14 years into an indigenous socialist government. But we asked people to redefine art according to the cosmovision and worldview of their respective nations. And simply said, if we live in a country that recognizes 36 different nations as equal, we might as well propose 36 different notions of art that are equal in front of the institution. This included to make guided tours in the museum. La Paz is in an Aymara territory. So the biggest part of the population is actually Aymara, descendant from Aymaras. And we would make guided tours, like free guided tours for the public in Aymara language, so that we would have to face talking about art with this different notion of art that is not artist, what is beautiful is hanging on the wall, but that can mean things that are done with your hands, etc. And we naturally have to redefine the way how we speak about art, because simply language and worldview, cosmovision differ. And we need to learn to talk different about art. So these were some of the things that we did in order to implement the idea of a plurinational museum of art. So.
Hi, thanks for coming. Sounds rather miraculous what has changed. To both rewrite a constitution and to redefine what a museum, a national museum is. I mean, it gives me goosebumps to hear that can actually happen, given the color of our country right now and what's not happening, and the lack of any ability to listen and possibly change someone's mind. Do you think that happened primarily because it is 2/3 Indigenous people who were willing to work together? How do you think that was able, how could they rewrite a constitution?
Yeah, it happened because I'm convinced that a country like Bolivia needs to go this way, because the absolute majority belongs to historically oppressed group of people. So whatever kind of democratic majority-based process needs to take place will have the backup of these people. It took, though, quite a long time for movements to organize, to build alliances that were strong enough to lead to this historical process, right? And I'm very glad to see that in different Latin American countries, Bolivia has been taken as an example and is being followed. And even though Bolivia is a country that has a rather big indigenous population percentage, compared to other countries, it still works as an example to be followed. And we can see that in the protests, be it in Colombia, in Peru, in Chile, in Argentina, that the wave, the flag, the huipala, which is the Andean rainbow flag, which represents the indigenous nations of the Americas. And it is great to see that as a historical example, it can be followed and that people are demanding rewriting their constitutions.
And they always had a vote.
Excuse me?
Everyone always had a vote, equal vote.
This is also very complex historical processes in which first, as you know very well in the US also, it was not a given that everyone had a vote, even though, you know, the ideologues of the colonial and post-colonial republic or of the United States in that sense, you know, it took quite some time for social movements to really conquer the right to vote. And it is still not a given, right? Be it Black population, indigenous populations, women's rights, still women do not have the right to choose over their own body, for example. This is something that it's still a process, it's still ongoing, and it needs, I think, a big political impetus. And what I claim, what I say, what I try to discuss here with you is that we understand that culture has always been an instrument to the dominant hegemonic forces. And since it is a very powerful instrument, we might as well appropriate it in order to bring forward a political struggle for equality.
Hi, and thank you. I wanted to talk about art, but the politics really pull me. Here in this country, I feel like many of us have felt this shock that someone like Trump could get in and all of these things could be happening. And yet I've always felt that as white Christian extremism started to become the minority, started to be threatened, that this was kind of inevitable. And so I guess my hope is that as that this dominant group keeps losing numbers, that perhaps democracy could rise, although sometimes I get scared it's too late, or we'll just lose the country to climate change and drought and all the things we're not taking care of and water rights. But I don't really know if I have a question. I have a worry about this country. I have a sense that much of what we're going through was kind of inevitable. I don't know if that's right, but that's just always been my hunch. And I do think that it is the growth of the former minority groups that can save us. I would include myself among that for various reasons, either here nor there, but I just wonder what you think when you look at the United States and what, you know, this whole, well, really the whole European, you know, struggle of the right wing rising and how much that might have to do with this grasping now. And I also worry that, I'll just leave you with this, that there's so much money here that I don't know if, you know, if it can ever really be let go of. I don't know right now. Let go of, shared, redistributed, all that good thing, all that good stuff. Wonder what you think.
I think I mentioned it at the beginning. I think we're experiencing a historical moment in which we see a shift in our political horizon to the right, and this shift implies that people like Donald Trump can, as while being president of a country and such a powerful one as the United States, can be just that openly racist and supportive of white supremacist groups. And you have that in other countries like Brazil, where I lived for many years, where you have a president who just expresses himself in the same way. In Bolivia, with the coup d'etat, you had a neo-fascist groups that would enter, or representatives of these groups who would enter with the Bible into the presidential palace and speak about using the same language that the Catholic priests used in the 16th century to say, you know, we're going to extirpate the indigenous deities from the presidential palace. You have like very openly racist and sexist ideologues that are manifesting themselves in hierarchical positions, being presidents, you know, the highest position within a government that is built on supposed democracy. And what I would like to remind you is that sometimes things that we consider to be like right, like the beauty of a painting, or the idea to think that democracy is the morally speaking the highest stage in the development of a country we could come. I mean, look at the United States. Look what is being called democracy. Look what how insulting this is to the people who are not equal. And you know, there's a Brazilian singer was called Chico Science, and Chico Science had this song saying, "Um hombre roubado nunca se engana," which means a man who was stolen never se engana. Yeah, someone who got stolen, you know, is never wrong about that he got stolen, he or her, right? So if you get robbed, you know you've been robbed. So speaking about democracy in contemporary liberal societies and for the last hundreds of years, speaking about equality is just an insult to everyone who gets robbed and sacked all the time and knows exactly what that means, right? You don't get robbed and do not notice. So in countries like the US, speaking about democracy is a tough one. I would, you know, wonder, if we ask the people who get robbed and violated on a daily basis, you know, what with what kind of face do you look someone in the eye who has that experience every day and talk about democracy? You know, this is just it's very insulting. So we are living through very tough times in which people who are openly racist, sexist, defending, supporting white supremacist groups, violent groups, armed forces, fascist armed forces, presidents who support these people speak about democracy. And I think we're wrong in so many ways and levels, and we need to redefine our notions, our most ingrained and you know, things that we thought were safe places like human rights, democracy, beauty. We might rethink all of that.
Maybe in the meantime, I'll just quickly say the chat. Joe says, I work for one of America's oldest museums. I found a Khmer Buddhist stone head in its collection with no provenance. Curators said they will look more into it, but as a Cambodian American, this well aware of the looting of the nation's many Buddhist temples, how should I reconcile this revelation in relation to the museum optics of diversity, equity, accessibility, inclusion, initiatives, and decolonization?
I'm not sure if I understood everything correctly.
Joe works at a museum in Connecticut, And this museum had a lost piece of Khmer Buddhist stone head in the basement with no provenance. So the museum has like most museums and institutions now in the US have optical urges for diversity, equity, accessibility, inclusion that are don't actually go in and find the stolen heads to clean that up. They're just optics. That's more or less what he's saying.
Yeah. I think it's all complex processes, and you know, claiming rights or institutions or complex historical processes, and they need to start somewhere. So awareness, public awareness, is a crucial fundamental issue. I think one has to create as much public opinion about it as possible, and I think that we're in an important historical moment. Not only the political horizon on an institutional level has shifted to the right, but there's also a contested, it's contested.
Mm-hmm.
So there are many movements, social rights movements, or also in the cultural field movements that claim restitution. And so on. And it's important that this rises and gets air. We might very well understand that even though we live in a fortunate moment, let's say historically, there are claims for restitution, claims for equality that to a certain way have been unparalleled since perhaps the 60s, 1960s, which also, let's understand the 1960s were important because they were on the very high rise of African independence movements and many countries becoming independent. And so that today we have this kind of idea that we can decolonize, that we can restitute, we can claim equality and so on, is very important, and we have to stick to it. We can see that historically, we can see that this might be very well over very fast, right? So we just need to get the most out of it and try to create structures that are reliable for these processes on legal terms also. Don't know if
so I'm going into the direction. I'm going to summarize and say agitate now.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have a quick question. We're going towards the contemporary art angle. I think that the solutions that you proposed around like clearly colonial artworks as having discussion around them is pretty clear. But of course also all contemporary art is influenced by colonial aesthetics, and how we value beauty is influenced by colonial aesthetics. So as a curator, and therefore like kind of inherently a certain type of gatekeeper in contemporary art, how do you kind of grapple with these ideas of beauty in working with contemporary artworks?
I would say the same thing that I said about colonial art. We need to study contemporary art in order to understand it. If we like to decolonize contemporary art, we must understand how it works, how it operates. When I talk about the depth that we maintain with beauty, right? And if I signal on whose back this experience of beauty is built historically, that same thing might be said about contemporary art in terms of it is a known thing, even though since the so-called fall of the Iron Curtain, like the end of the Cold War, it is not so much discussed, but during the period of the Cold War, after this, let's say from the First World War on, from the Russian Revolution, let's say, to the end of the Cold War in 1990, it was pretty clear in the world, since there were two halves, to make it very reduced, like there was the supposedly free and democratic imperialist force, right? And there was the socialist equalitarian
socialism that that moved towards communism, and for the socialists, it was clear that the liberals or the imperialists would defend the supposed freedom or liberty of art as an ideological tool. And it was clear that the idea that art had to be free was an ideological construct of colonialism. Interesting enough, beginning of the 20th century, thinkers and political leaders like Vladimir Lenin understood that imperialism and colonialism is inseparable. Let's say capitalism can only exist through colonialism. And within this idea that up to the end of the Cold War was clear that there's such implications as that freedom, the freedom of the imperialist nations and the core group, let's say the wealthy amongst this imperialist nations, they can only be free and wealthy built through structures such as colonialism, implying racism, etc. And that art, which is the delight of the free white people, only functions to an ideological narrative of liberty and freedom that, as we know, because we know that colonialism exists, you know, is an ideological narrative. So the idea that art would be beautiful and free was long understood as an ideological narrative. After the end of the Cold War, we kind of seems to pass on to accept that it's like that. And it is a very short time. We're talking about like 30 years ago, right? So it is interesting to see how strong certain, let's say, buzzwords of ideological, colonial, neo-colonial nature are, such as, you know, freedom and beauty, and how deeply they are within the structures that we deal with working with art, be it art educational institutions or museums. Or so this is why I say we need to like urgently rethink the notions that we thought are on the very fundament of our notion of art. Because only 30 years ago, for half of the globe, like if we think of it divided by the Iron Curtain, for half of the globe, it was clear that the idea that art has to be free and beautiful was an ideological, imperialist, neo-colonial slur, right? And so, yeah, we might well, you know, give it a different angle.
So where do you see the responsibility of the artist in this?
Well, as a citizen, as a political agent, I think if we want to claim equality, I know, you know, we can confuse democracy, equality, and so on. But if we're speaking strictly about equality, each one has to be part of this. So artists too. Artists are, you know, working people, are often public figures, do have a rather a public relation to other people instead of other fields of, you know, professional fields in which the relation of the worker and clients or whatever is much more private and more invisible. I think artists are privileged people in terms of possible political agency because they work in a public field and with visibility, and it might be in any ways a work of the artist to create visibility where there has not been visibility before, be it about, you know, an angle on beauty, or be it about bodies that are beautiful, or whatever colors that are beautiful. You know, the work of the artist in the strict Western notion is very much linked to visibilization of structures and things and issues, contents. And so I think it's a privileged field as a modern artist, if you like, or artist, visual artist in the modern sense, to work on processes of visibilization. And I think I would not contradict processes of artistic creation, you know, if they are about visibilization. I think that this is a good thing.
So, read Vin's. Vin says it can't be.
Thanks.
It can't be reconciled, IMHO, except to say that, as with many things, the reality the museum wants to portray is that they are sensitive to such things and care, as decolonization, that they would care. The real is that they don't want to take responsibility for anything, if at all possible. The sublime is that they are still racist, classist, colonial-minded assholes. So
there was a comment, but it was not a question.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think maybe this is a good time to take a break to say thank you for the discussion, and let's take a 10-15 minute break, and then we'll get back into the seminar. For those of you on the link, we're going to close this link and open up the seminar link. Okay.
Thanks again to all of you.
Thank you.